Hey, welcome back to Rooster Teeth at E3, presented by Jason Bourne. We're here with Alexander Gondal, who's the senior producer on Battlefield 1. And we also happen to have a Battlefield 1 pro in the house.
Veteran of Battlefield 1. I was part of the 64-player tournament that you all held during the EA event.
Yeah, how was that?
That was a blast. When I first played Battlefield 1942 back in the day, I just loved it. You know, it was one of the first games that I can recall that had, you know, a player that could walk around and then get into a vehicle and drive the vehicle and get out, which now sounds like a very commonplace thing. Very revolutionary for the time. So I played a ton of Battlefield. I loved all the classes. And so playing Battlefield 1942, now to today playing Battlefield 1, it feels like 1942, but all the evolutions later. It feels like it's got all the mechanics and all the unlockables and the sophistication of Battlefield 4. So I had a blast playing it.
Yeah, I'm glad you say that. I actually get a little bit of the same feeling when I play the game as well. I get some of those 1942 vibes that bring me back all those happy memories.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. In fact, it was really cool to see that there's a medic class back now, because Battlefield 4 did not have a dedicated medic class.
No.
And now it's back for Battlefield 1.
Yeah. So we like to mix it up a little bit. We did some changes to the classes. You know, we have removed the engineer class.
Right.
So the engineer class is now split into the tanker and the pilot,
mm-hmm.
which is a separate kind of vehicle class. That if you decide to spawn into the vehicles, you become either a pilot or a tanker. So instead of being, you know, an assault guy in a tank, or an assault guy in the plane, you're the pilot in the plane. That's the idea. So it's a known class. It has its own gears and weapons that comes with it.
Yeah, I had that experience when I was playing, and I spawned in a tank, drove it around. Of course, I drove it to the point where it was no longer operable, had to get out. And when I got out, I was like really surprised at my weapon set because I didn't remember choosing a class, but I was surprised. It's like I had my pistol and I was trying to switch to anything else. It's like, oh, that's not who you are. You don't have your assault rifle.
No, so essentially the idea is that as a pilot or a tanker, your main weapon is the vehicle. So that's your kind of primary weapon. So that's the idea that you should be. Did you notice that you could spawn in as in different types of tanks, right? You could choose what tank to spawn in. Yeah, so then that's essentially the same thing as choosing your primary weapon as you go into the game.
And then, of course, the big introduction for this iteration of Battlefield for vehicles is the Zeppelin,
horses.
The behemoth.
Oh, wait, sorry, my bad.
Horses, too. But from what I got to play, the big thing was the behemoth, the airship that comes in. And can you explain the mechanic of how that worked? Like, how does that spawn?
Yeah, sure. So you played on Conquest, right? So that was the Conquest game mode. And the way it works for Conquest is that the team that is lagging behind will get reinforced with the behemoth, and in this case, the airship. So the idea here is to help the team that is lagging a little bit behind to get back on their feet. Because I think that, and I hope you agree with me, that the most fun Battlefield matches are the matches that are really, really close.
Totally agree.
Yeah, so that's the idea. It's a pretty powerful thing, so it should be able to, take control over vast areas of the map itself. So it, you know, whether or not you're in a plane or on the ground, you should watch out for this thing, or even try to take it down, which is also, when you manage to do that, you know, it goes down in a fireball, right?
So. And the map we played on was the one where it had a windmill at the top of the hill, and it was the city. I don't know the name of the map. It might not be named.
San Quentin Scar, it's called.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that's one of the ones that we played on, and that was the one on which the behemoth, the airship, came against our team. We took it down. It crashed on the town, and it was like it crashed in front of me. It was this massive event that took place. There was some of the footage that we just showed of it being taken down by planes, but then the wreckage landed on the town, took out houses, and then we were running through the wreckage of the airship. That was, never had an experience like that in Battlefield. Yeah, that was really tremendous.
Did Gavin crash the Zeppelin?
He was on it. Unfortunately, when we had the behemoth, I did not get the opportunity to spawn on it.
Yeah, you should surf on it when it's going down.
I've heard about some experiences.
Yeah, so you said, as it's going down, if you're on the right end of it, obviously, don't want to be on the burning end of it. But if you're on the other end of it, you can surf on it at least for a while. That's a pretty fun moment right there.
And the balance that you talk about, too, with it's not just even who wins or loses the round, but a team that's dominating another team, it's just inevitable in a lot of games that they'll just win the round and you're just kind of waiting for the round to end. But then when something like the behemoth shows up, it gives the dominating team another challenge to face.
Like, exactly.
Yeah, it changes their experience as well.
Exactly. It's part of the whole kind of dynamic elements that we like to add to our Battlefield. We really want to make it feel like every time you play it, it's a new type of experience. There's new things that happen. I don't know if you noticed that the weather did change as you played as well.
I was pretty focused on my reticle. I didn't notice it, but that sounds
okay.
Great.
So the weather is actually changing as you play. It can go from like perfect daylight to like rain to all fog, and this should also change the way that you play, because you have to adapt to those situations. So if it's in the full fog, obviously you can't do the long range sniping or you need to be a bit careful when you're in the tank, because people really like to sneak up on you. Mm-hmm. If you're in the fog there, so you have to be a bit careful. Another thing is that, generally speaking, if you're in the fog, for instance, as an attacker on an objective, you have a slightly advantage because you can move in much closer. Whereas if you are a defender in the fog, then obviously it's a little bit more different, because they'll be right on you immediately. As opposed to in sunlight, where you can see them coming from miles away.
Right.
Yeah.
And it's like sunlight definitely played in for me, where when someone was coming at me out of the sun, even, you know, on a hill and the sun was low in the sky, I was at a huge disadvantage, like looking into the sun with my character. And it's like I had to like move to the side and get to a place where I wasn't looking directly into the sunlight. So it's like I did experience the environmental effects in that way.
Yeah, so that's we want to take it in the way that you know, we are pretty proud of our dynamic sandbox. That's kind of the elements that you get to play with destruction and now the weather. And I don't know if you saw this, but you can actually make some pretty big craters on the map by dropping bombs on there, which also adds some kind of new gameplay opportunities, I would say. You can hide in them, and yeah.
That town was a lot prettier before we started. It was, you know, and it's. Let's talk a little bit about the setting for World War One.
Yeah, is it difficult? Like, you've gone, you know, started in 42, and then you guys did, there was 2142, and it's jumped around a bit, but it's tended to go, like, to add technology through, you know, a lot of the various iterations of the game. Is it difficult figuring out how to take it back a notch to, like, lower levels of technology while keeping the intensity of the gameplay experience?
Yeah, so there's kind of two ways that I like to look at it like that. So first of all, you know, mechanically, system-wise, it's an evolution of our previous Battlefield titles. So you can see it as a sequel. Technology-wise, and the way that we think about making games, Battlefield 1 is a modern shooter by all means. That's what we try to be. So that doesn't mean that we can't turn back the hands on the clock and go back in time. I don't see those as kind of mutually exclusive. Mm-hmm. So we look at it like this. So when we see an opportunity in that time period, and there's a lot of cool and unique opportunities that lie there, because there was so many weird designs on vehicles and weapons that existed, and that to us, that is just adding more unique gameplay. Mm-hmm. We can make new and unique experiences out of these new old vehicles, and I think the challenge lies in there instead, about how do you maximize the fun out of those vehicles. Generally speaking, you know, I think games have moved a lot towards playing the UI, which is something that I personally don't like a lot. You know, we spend millions and millions of dollars crafting these fantastic experiences, and you end up just shooting at the UI, which is something that I think we're kind of dialing, since we don't have any automatic systems or anything like that. Mm-hmm. There's no lock-ons, there's no blips and bloops. It's pretty straightforward. So you kind of, what you see is what you get. You kind of play the game world more.
Mm-hmm. I definitely felt more in this game that I was spending more time in foxholes and like using the landscape to hide myself. Not just cover of bushes, but actually like hiding over a berm from somebody who was in a tank or something like that. And I have to say too, that's like World War One. It is a step back, but it's also, it introduces new elements, because World War One was it was chemical warfare, you know. And one of the dedicated keys I was playing on the controller, I didn't know we could use keyboard and mouse. Was you can it's a dedicated control for putting your gas mask on.
That's right.
But I didn't experience anything like that. You know, it made me nervous of seeing fog for sure. But can you talk about that aspect of it?
Yeah. So there is an element of poison gas in the game. You can throw a grenade that contains it. You can even drop them from planes, or even the tank itself can kind of create a cloud around it to get people away from you as a defensive measurement. So, and all soldiers are equipped with the gas mask, so you can equip it at any point in time if you get exposed to this. The drawback here is that, of course, there's a little bit of a peripheral vision reduction that you get, but the other part is that you can't aim down sights when you're in the gas mask. Mm. So it's kind of like a choice that you have to make as a player, which I think is interesting. It's like, okay, do I want to run and try to get out of this, or do I put on my mask? Do I charge through it, you know, with a bayonet charge right through the gas? This is up to the players to kind of figure out what they want to do with it.
And I love the environments. You captured the trench warfare because there was trenches all the way through the map that I was playing on. But then in the trailer as well, you showed shelling, which was a very important part of World War One. How does that play into the game?
So shelling, and you know, we have all kinds of explosives in our game. So first of all, we have bombs being dropped from planes. That's mm-hmm. that's kind of a big thing. That's a kind of player driven. You drop the bomb on people, which is pretty fun. There's mortars. There's other things that I really can't talk about.
Okay.
But of course, explosives is fun to a point. You don't want to get it too explosive, then it just shake all the time. The camera shakes all the time. So,
right.
Yeah.
And like you see here, that some of the gameplay footage we're showing now there, in particular,
right.
showing the destructible environments as you run through these houses. I mean, you can really change the landscape on what you're playing.
Yeah, here we also see a bit of the rain in that part of the trailer. See also that we have the new enter vehicle animations as well.
And I can, my experience playing too, so it was a tournament where there were some, you know, YouTubers, there were some Battlefield pros that were playing, and then some celebrities as well. I was right next to Wiz Khalifa, and it was fun to watch him. He was so aggravated by the people on the planes, you know, that were taking him out. But then later in the round, he got on the behemoth, and he was like, it was total payback for him. He was just having a blast, just like destroying everybody else. Yeah, here's one of the shelling sequences here. So, which was, you know, kind of a hallmark of World War One warfare. So.
Yeah, so actually that little sequence right there is, you know, the crew that is stuck in the tank. It's a little sequence from our campaign.
Okay.
While most of the other footage is taken from multiplayer. So there you kind of see a little snippet of what the campaign is about. The campaign is, you know, we did things a little bit different with the campaign this time around. And rather than just having one character that you play through the whole game, you're actually playing multiple different characters through the whole game. So you kind of get to experience different stories throughout the whole entire world, pretty much. And I think it's quite interesting because you get some sort of perspectives. We can kind of tell different perspectives of how people reacted to being inside this era and how the world changes around them.
Yeah, you know, that's one thing that when the title was announced as Battlefield 1, that made us wonder a little bit if you'd be jumping around in time as well as location, given that some of the earlier titles in the series were 1942, 2142. They were year-based, whereas this one, it didn't say a year. So are you jumping around in time?
No, yeah, you're jumping around, not necessarily in time, but you're jumping around inside this era, you could say. This, mm-hmm. The World War One era, which is 1914 to 1918, mm-hmm. So it's not huge jumps in time. But so these stories kind of take place during this time, essentially.
Mm-hmm. And then you mentioned you'll be playing different characters, so there are, you'll see different theaters, almost like different campaigns for the various players that you take on?
Yeah, so you'll be going to many different places and seeing the world from many different perspectives, yes.
Yeah, you know, it's cool. It seems like people have been very hungry for this. They're very excited for the World War One setting. They're excited to see it go back. And it's classic, but it also adds so much, like, freshness, I guess. You've got the Zeppelins, you've got horses, you're seeing, you know, it looks like the African theater, all kinds of like new opportunities to explore by going backwards.
Yeah, so we got inspired by also looking at, you know, these black and white photographs that you might have seen.
Mm-hmm.
We were all thinking kind of like, how do you bring these things to life? And we really been trying to work, you know, to get this to feel like a modern game, like, mm-hmm. How would this look like with modern cameras? If you were actually there, you know, 100 years back in time, what would it look like? So that's where we kind of draw our inspiration from. It should be like looking through a modern lens on the landscapes,
well,
that you see.
Well, I think you guys nailed it, because there was a lot of times I felt like I was playing in a war movie, you know. And then the other aspect of Battlefield as well is that it's a very competitive franchise. And during the EA presentation, they talked about their EA leagues, and then during the Microsoft, they talked about Arena, which is their tournament system that's being baked in now to the Xbox. Any plans to take advantage of those? And
so we are excited about the future of esports in the franchise, but we're not ready to talk about it just yet.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I'm really looking forward to it. I mean, just, you know, the Microsoft announcing those tournaments was something I felt like they promised on the dashboard of the 360 years and years ago. So hopefully we'll see something about that.
It does seem like it's been coming for a while. But we were going to take some questions from Twitter using the hashtag RTE3, from the live chat as well. But then we thought we'd also play a little bit of a game, because you think you know what questions are coming.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Some of them. Yeah, I've been reading my Twitter this morning, so I'm just waiting for those questions to come.
Well, right. The first one I ask here is from Tommy Pierce. He's asking, can you tell us if there will be a flamethrower in the game?
Oh, yes, there will be flamethrowers.
Really?
In the game. Yes, absolutely. Well, I can't reveal exactly how they will play out, but definitely that's a huge, strong kind of imagery that we really want to play into. So,
right.
Yep, it will be there.
Okay. We also have, this is a fun one, when a cyclist on Twitter asks, any chance of Lawrence of Arabia?
Any chance of Lawrence of Arabia? Yeah, that's a good question. I'm going to leave it at that.
Okay.
And I think one of the things is everybody gets a little patriotic when they play Battlefield, and they like to play on their country's side. This question came in particular from a Canadian. He wants to know... it's Darmok Starchild wants to know, will Canadians be playable in Battlefield 1?
See, that's the question I was waiting for.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, but, you know, I was waiting for the question, but replace the land, the country with another country.
Right.
Oh. Or the other country.
Everyone wants to know about their nationality.
Exactly. So what we did in this game is that we really wanted to try to represent as broad as in multiplayer kind of perspective as we possibly can. We wanted to paint a big picture across the board. So we actually have 6 armies in the game that you'll be playing in multiplayer. Obviously, we can't fit all the armies in at launch, so that's not really possible for us. So we focused on the ones that we felt were providing the kind of biggest perspective on the war, so we could go to some really interesting places.
Right.
So that was kind of, okay, where do we want to go? And then we looked at who are there, and then we picked the kind of armies based on that. So unfortunately, the Canadians doesn't show up just yet. I'm not saying they will. I'm not saying they won't either. And that's for all. If you replace that country with Belgium or any other country that might make Australia or whatever, I think that we have a huge future ahead of us.
It's a long war.
It's a long war, and we're committed to, you know, keeping this game alive by adding more content and keeping it alive. So. Who knows what the future might bring?
On a related note, since everyone wants to feel like the hero, Irish Nord Gaming asks if there will be hero classes.
There will be hero classes. I don't know exactly what he means by hero classes, but are you thinking about sort of like the Star Wars hero classes?
I'm getting the feeling from the question that it's a reference very much to Battlefront and the heroes in Battlefront, and if something, a feature like that will make an appearance in Battlefield 1.
No, so I think our games are very different, so I wouldn't say that something like that would appear in our game.
But I would say like the Behemoth is a big event. That's like a new, unique thing to the Battlefield franchise that takes place. Yeah.
Yeah.
And then one of the things that people are asking about constantly is the armored character that appears in the reveal trailer, the first one. There's a lot of different names from here. The medieval guy, the armored dude, the knight. Can you talk about that character at all?
Is he officially the armored dude?
Yeah, you can call him the armored dude. That's it. Yes, I think that one of the cool things about this era is all the really interesting things that they did, and they did actually go up and dress up in this armor, and yes, that will play some role in the game. So yes, you will be seeing him. I don't think I should say more than that.
Okay,
we'll keep an eye out for the armored dude.
Yeah,
does programming or developing a game based on the different eras of combat? It just seems to me that the earlier eras, the balance is more kind of baked in because technology was more balanced back then. Is that the case?
I don't know. I don't really see it like that. I think we always kind of, when we get all the elements in place, we always spend a lot of time trying to balance it out. So it's like hours of hours of playtesting. And balance is, it's not something that is just, you know, done. It's never done.
Right.
It can always get better.
Well, it seems like balance is a process.
Yeah, it's a process. So we kind of feedback. We play the game every day. We feedback to the designers making tweaks. And we feedback to designers making tweaks. Also working with our community that is feedbacking us. Giving us... So we're working with them. And it will continue after we have shipped the game as well. So the same thing as with Battlefield 4. That kept being rebalanced multiple times.
Sure. And the players, by their nature, are always trying to get an advantage. In a way, they're always trying to break that balance, you know, with either their skills or just by finding a new way to approach the game, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I think Battlefield has so many elements to it, so someone is always clever and finds a way to kind of make something really powerful and you know, make use of it.
I have yet to find any of those myself so far. So,
Max McGovern, actually, this is a great question. Is what's the most interesting fact you didn't know about World War One that you learned working on this game?
So, a really smart guy told me here the other week that probably during World War One was the last time someone actually got hit with a lance from a guy riding a horse.
Really?
Yeah. So there was actually people riding in with lances at some point during
it. Any chance of a lancer class?
Why?
So I just found out about this last week, so I haven't figured out what to do with it. But I thought it was a pretty fascinating piece of fact that people are actually riding in with lances. I thought that was medieval stuff.
Well, luckily you have an armored dude in the game
exactly.
already.
Just give him a visor, give him a horse.
Horse
you
and
got horses
lance.
In the game already?
You're all set.
Oh, I'm done.
Now, are horses going to be in multiplayer as well, or are they single player campaign only?
I'm sorry, what?
Horses.
Oh, yeah. So horses will be present to both the single player and the multiplayer.
Fantastic.
Yeah. Right.
Well, so we still have a dream of becoming a lancer alive.
Yeah, I would love to do it. It gives a whole new term to lance corporal. You can
I will
that.
Add that on my list.
Fabulous.
Well, can you tell us when we're going to be able to play Battlefield 1 when everyone else will be able to experience it?
Yeah, so first we'll have an open beta coming later this summer. So if you're going to want to go to battlefield.com and become an insider, you'll figure out when to join that first. The game ships worldwide on October 21st.
Can't wait. One of my favorite franchises of all time. Battlefield 1, I got a chance to play it for just 3 rounds, and I can't wait to get my hands on it again. Alex, thank you for joining us.
Thank you.